Hello, hello, hello. How do you do? At Pleasant Green Baptist Church, we're delighted to see you. We're exalting Christ, embracing community, and engaging culture. Hello, hello, hello from Pleasant Green. Good morning, Pleasant Green. How grateful we are and thankful for the gift of your presence with us on this morning in this virtual worship experience. We praise God for your presence. We praise God for his presence, his power, and his protection in our lives. He has taken us all the way from storm to storm, situation to situation. And for that, he's worthy to praise and worship this morning. So as we could come now to our moment of worship, let's enter into worship with a spirit of praise on our hearts and on our lips. In Jesus' name, let's praise him together.
Hello, hello, hello. How do you do? At Pleasant Green Baptist Church, we're so glad to see you. We're exalting Christ, embracing community, and engaging culture. Hello, hello, hello from Pleasant Green. Remember, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let's worship him with the singing of hymns and praising of songs.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I hope you enjoy the service. Please remember to get to Pleasant Green Baptist Church. Thank you and have a wonderful day.
Brothers and sisters, as we enter into this fall season, we're going to be talking about how a praise breaks, how a praise breaks out, how that praise just breaks out in every situation, every circumstance, and every place that we find ourselves, because God is seeking the praise of his people. He is seeking it to be inhabited in the praise of his people, to be exhibited in the praise of his people. And so even the word says, let's just praise the Lord. So come and let's praise the Lord over this fall season and this fall session that we're going to be talking about praise breaking. And we're going to be looking at how praise just simply breaks out in different seasons and different situations in our lives. We're going to examine God's people praising and worshiping him for who he is and for what he does. We intend to look at the who, what, when, where, and why, and how God's people have praised and worshiped him throughout history and throughout our time. And what does it mean for us in the process and in our present time right now? What does it mean for us to praise God? What does it look like? What does it sound like? How can it be evidenced in our heart and in our spirits and in our minds and in our soul and every fiber of our being that God gives to us? What are some of the ways or patterns in which God has given us to express our heart's desire and praise for him? And that's the title of the first message, What's the Pattern of Praise? In this first little messages, we're going to be looking at the pattern of praise, how that actually happens in the context of the Christian and in their life. And our first passage for this series is found in Exodus chapter 15. In Exodus chapter 15, just a little context, the children of Israel have gone through now the Red Sea. God has delivered them mightily, and Moses is there, and he has held up his arms, and they watched Pharaoh and his army be drowned in the Red Sea. And as Exodus 15 picks up, we see this pattern playing out. We're going to start with verse 11, but just to context, Moses and all Israel is singing a song. And verse 11 picks up and says, Lord, who is like you among all the gods? Who is like you, glorious in holiness, revered with praise, performing wonders to behold? You stretched out your right hand and the earth swallowed them. With your faithful love, you will lead your people that you have redeemed, that you have guided them to this holy dwelling by your strength, by your strong arm. The Lord will reign forever and ever. Now, when Pharaoh's horses with his chariots and horsemen went into the sea, the Lord brought the water of the sea back over them. But the Israelites walked through the sea on dry ground. Then the prophetess Miriam, who was Aaron's sister, she took a tambourine in her hand, and all of the women came out following her with tambourines and with dancing. And Miriam sang this song, "Sing to the Lord, for he is highly exalted. He has thrown the horse and its rider into the sea." Yes, brothers and sisters, do you hear all of the singing? You hear all of the praise? You hear all of the things that are happening in there? And so in this message today, as we look at the pattern of praise, and the pattern of praise that we're going to examine today is the pattern of singing, and how singing gives praise to God in every situation and every circumstance of our life. And so as we examine this passage today, we want to look at first how singing praise, and when we're singing praise to God, how those patterns occur, how those patterns happen. And the first point of the message today is when we're singing praise, we ought to be singing praise spontaneously. Oh yes, brothers and sisters, Israel had been slaves for 400 years. They had suffered under the oppressive regime of Pharaoh in Egypt, and all of the leaders of Israel for 400 years. Remember, they had gone down into Egypt because of Joseph protecting and preserving them when there was a famine in the land, and Israel brought all of his boys down into Egypt, and they had grown into a mighty group of people, and Egypt looked at them and said, they're going to overthrow us one day if we don't do something about them. And Egypt enslaved Israel, the Hebrews, for 400 years. But now it was time for God to show his hand, to show himself strong. And his prophet Moses, the one he had called, the one who he had saved from sheer destruction as a child, was now on the scene and ready to deliver them, had led them to the Red Sea and embraced them and got them over, delivered them. And God had told them, even before Moses came on the scene, that he was going to deliver them. He had shown signs and wonders to them that he was going to deliver them. But now that Moses has shown up, now that Moses has spoken to Pharaoh, now that Moses has cast down consequences on Egypt for all of their false worship and false gods and all of these things, and Egypt has told Israel to get out of here and go, and Israel has borrowed a whole lot of things and got gold and silver and food and clothing and cloth and all of these kinds of things from the Egyptians, and they have crossed the Red Sea. And they've seen Pharaoh's army now being drowned, and yet they had never sang before. There had never been any singing that they had done. There had never been a recorded song of Israel. But now Israel records a song. Moses burst out spontaneously in song, seeing Pharaoh's army cast into the sea. Why now? What happened? What changed in their situation? Because Israel had seen the good hand of a great God do a marvelous work to deliver them from captivity. He had promised that he was going to do it, but he had not yet performed it. And now in this moment, it has been performed. And so after its performance, Moses, filled with wonder and awe and glory and praise for God's delivery of what he had promised to do, and seeing him performing what he had said he would do, spontaneously breaks out in prayer. Because other signs and wonders that had been performed earlier were simply coincidental to Moses, consequential to the Egyptians, but it had not changed their situation. But at this moment, Moses realized that their situation had been permanently changed. And because of that permanent change in their situation, Moses, filled with excitement and emotion about seeing God do the work and wonder in his own life, just around him, caused him to burst out in praise. And brothers and sisters, the same thing ought to be happening in our hearts and in our situations in life. When we see the wonder and the work of God happening and occurring in our life, we ought to be filled with excitement and the emotion of the moment in seeing God do wonderful works in our life. And not just work around us, causes us to burst out in singing, just thinking about the goodness of the Lord, how good he is, what he has done for you, makes you want to sing of his praises, makes you want to burst out in song, makes you want to bellow out a note or two here and there. God's goodness becomes real to you. When it becomes real to you, brothers and sisters, you can't help but to sing. Even if you don't know how to sing real good, you just sing because it's in your spirit. It's in your heart. It compels you to sing out and listen at the words that Moses used in this song. And we can use them even in our life today. Who is like you, O God? Who is like you? Fearful, wonderful, holy, you who redeem, you who guide, strengthened, who has strengthened us, healed us, helped us, held on to us, delivered us, made us possible, redeemed us out of slavery, led us through captivity. Now you are fighting for us. Your strong arm is there for us. God, who is like unto you? Moses' song, just like the songs that we sing, the songs, the hymns, the spiritual songs, the gospels that we sing, in our sanctuaries and in our homes and in our spirits and in our services online, everywhere that we sing and we sing with God, they serve as a reminder of his great work of creation, of his great work of salvation. It reflects on the wonders of his person and his personhood, his power and his majesty. And it reestablishes a sense of worship in us, a sense of wonder and a sense of awe that God is worthy to be praised. And he's not worthy to simply be praised because he does so many wonderful things for us. He's worthy of our praise simply because of who he is. And thinking about the goodness of God and just simply who he is ought to make us break out in song spontaneously. Not only that, brothers and sisters, we see in this text, in this passage in Exodus, that singing praise spontaneously ought to happen in our life. But we also see that singing praise sufficiently ought to happen in our life. Egypt may not have known who God was. Egypt may not have understood how God had been working through Israel for so many years. Egypt may not have known the history of Abraham being called out of his daddy's house and going out into a place that God was going to show him. Egypt may not have known about the promises that were made to Abraham that he was going to be a mighty nation. Egypt may not have known the pilgrimage of Isaac and Jacob. Egypt may not have known all of the history of God's leading his people from a small place into this mine. They may not have known that Joseph was one of 12 children until he got there. See, they don't understand the history of how God was working in their life, but Israel did. Israel do, just like you and I know the history, and we know the hope, and we know what God has done with us, for us, through us, by us. We know everything that there is to know, that God has kept us through our situations, through our struggles, through our strife. And so when he is standing up on earth, our enemies may not know that the power and authority of God is at work in us, but we do. When we sing spontaneously, we have to sing sufficiently, knowing that the power of God, the history of God working in our life, and the presence of God in our life is sufficient enough to handle everything we've ever had to deal with. It's sufficient enough to deal with our humanity and our sin. It's sufficient enough to deal with our history and our struggles and what we have come through. It's sufficient enough to deal with our right here and now and every situation and circumstance that we're dealing with. And so, brothers and sisters, when we acknowledge that the authority and awesomeness of God is at work in our life, we must also be aware that our enemies are impacted by this situation, by this word again, by the work of God in our life. Even our enemies are impacted. Even our enemies become aware of what God is doing in our life. Egypt didn't know how good God was to them, to the Israelites. Egypt did not know until Moses showed up on the scene, because Israel had been groaning for 400 years. Israel had been oppressed for 400 years. Israel had been making bricks without straw for 400 years. Israel had been oppressed and under crazy draconian policies and procedures and laws that didn't make sense to anybody anywhere for 400 years. And yet now Egypt is at the mercy of a great God who's ready to deliver them, and he delivered them sufficiently and strongly. And so Egypt understood now that they were having to deal with not only a powerful people who were sick and tired of being oppressed, but now they were going to have to deal with a God who had a strong arm and a mighty signs and wonders and works in their life, who could deliver them sufficiently with all sufficiency through every struggle of their life. And so, brothers and sisters, the message for you and I, as the same message for Israel, is that when we're singing to God about his sufficiency, sufficiently in our life, we are singing not just to him, but we are singing to our enemies. And our enemies are understand that that they are not just our enemies, they are enemies to the God who has willing to save us and secure us and deliver us from all of our situations. We are letting our enemies know in the songs that we sing that my God is stronger, my God is greater, my God is bigger, he is higher than any other, he can do more than any other, he can do beyond anything anybody else can ever do. He is sufficient to deal with me and my circumstances and in my situations. And so when we sing of God, we can't minimize him or put him down or minimize him or what he is doing and going to do in our life. We must lift him up to the highest height that he can be. And so we sing sufficiently about him. We give him credit for fighting all of our battles, not just the ones that we can't handle, not just the ones that we don't want to fight. He is sufficient for everything that we need. He can handle all of our ups and our downs, our highs and our lows, our strikes and our blows. God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above and beyond anything and everything we can ask, imagine, think, or conceive. Remember that, brothers and sisters, when you sing to him sufficiently and sing of his sufficiency in your life. I guarantee you, when you think about the goodness of God and how abundantly blessed you are in all of the things that you're dealing with, you will not only sing spontaneously, but you will sing sufficiently. And brothers and sisters, we need to remember the words of Moses when we are singing sufficiently. Listen at what Moses says about the sufficiency of God. He says, your enemies will hear and be afraid when we come into the place that we're going. They will melt away because they will know that Israel is on the move. It is the Lord, Yahweh, Jehovah, God, who sits on high and looks low, that will reign forever and ever. It is not our enemies. It is not our foe. Praise him with singing and shouting because of his sufficiency. Moses suggests to Israel, as he suggests to you and I, you don't have to be afraid of any situation you are getting ready to go in. But if you are willing to break out and sing of his sufficiency in your life, he will go before you and he will fight your battle before you ever get there. Every situation and circumstance that you're looking down the road and trying to figure out how you're going to handle, break out in songs of praise and just start praising his name in song and see if the God and the Lord of hosts and the army that he has will not go before you if you sing of his sufficiency and his sufficiently in your life. His sufficiency is sufficient enough to fight every battle that you'll ever need. So sing of him sufficiently. So sing of him spontaneously, sing of him sufficiently. And watch this, brothers and sisters, as we get ready to go on this short message for the day, because I know you got Labor Day plans already that you start on Friday and Saturday, and you engage them as much on Sunday and Monday morning. Come on now with me. And when you're singing, sing, make sure you sing spiritually. Yes, brothers and sisters, Charles Spurgeon once upon a time said that there is a deep spiritual significance to a song, and to this specific song that Moses sang. And yes, there is, because this song carries weight all throughout the rest of the Old Testament, and it even shows up in Revelation in the New Testament, and it is mentioned by many of the writers in the New Testament in different parts and places. We should sing this song like Moses sang, and all of the songs that we sing, all of the gospel hymns that we sing, all of the hymns that we sing, all of the spirituals and soul-filled songs that we sing in the sanctuary and in our spirit with spontaneity and sufficiency ought to be sang spiritually as they deserve to be sung. Moses didn't just sing this song because he saw God deliver Israel from Egypt, though indeed he did see them do that. Moses didn't just sing this song Because they walked across on dry land, but indeed they did. Moses didn't just sing this song because Pharaoh's army got drowned in the Red Sea, but indeed they did. Moses did not sing this song just because their feet did not get muddy, but oh, indeed they did not. Moses knew that there would be other obstacles to overcome down the road. And so Moses sang this song to develop a spiritual sense of wonder and awe in the children of Israel, and we should sing these types of songs to develop a spiritual sense of wonder and awe in our spirits, because we know that even though Jesus has already come, even though Jesus has already died, even though Jesus has already paid the cost, even though Jesus has already fulfilled the promise, even though Jesus has already praying and putting us in a situation where we have power and authority over every obstacle, over every devil, over every demon, over every situation and circumstance in our life, we still have to sing because we still have stuff to overcome. He knows that we're going to do battle and have to beat back stuff in our lives. He knows that there will be foes for us to fight. He knows that there will be times of struggle and stress and strain and hard knock lives and hiccups and hindrances and all kinds of stuff that we will have to deal with on the way to our own promised land. Even though as Israel was on their way to their promised land, they had to remember that song was going to be in them. Miriam, even it's that same spirit that was in Moses dropped out on Miriam, and she took up a tambourine and started to play and dance and move, and spiritual filled with singing and movement. And brothers and sisters, we ought not to deny the spiritual influence in our life to give us song and dance and expression of the heart, because God is saying, I want you to dance all the way through your dilemma. I want you to play music all the way through the problems, pressures, and pains of your life and sing all the way as you struggle to get to the promised land. You're going to have to, listen, brothers and sisters, you and I both are going to stretch out on God, because we need him to stretch out his mighty hand to save us down the road and overthrow the principalities, powers, and rulers of darkness in high places who are putting policies together that are oppressing our people and putting us in situations that are worse than what we have to deal with ever before. And now they're doing it not under the cover of darkness anymore. They're doing it out in the open, out in the public square, and they're admitting that they racist in everything that they do. And brothers and sisters, we're going to have to sing some old songs all the way through. These people who are raising up their weak, wicked, and wounded heads against us, when we have been wicked and when we have been weak and when we have been wounded, when we have been wayward, when we are doing anything in our life, we have to remember the word of God, the sufficiency of God, the work of God, and the will of God in our life, and sing those things as we struggle through. Brothers and sisters, Moses knew, just like you and I know, that there's a Savior coming to save us. And so because we know that there was some Savior coming to save us, and what we know is what Moses didn't ever get to see, we know that he has come, and that he has done what he has said he was going to do. We've been planted by the shepherd. We've been possessed by his spirit, and we have been prepared to be his sanctuary, because he will be coming again to claim us of his own. And then, brothers and sisters, forever and ever, we will get to sing of the goodness of the Lord forever in our life. When we sing of his goodness forever, spiritually, salvifically, sufficiently, spontaneously, throughout eternity, I don't know how it's all gonna happen. I can't comprehend it, I can't understand it, but I do know this, and he shall reign forever and ever as King of kings and Lord of lords, God of all God. He is the one who we ought to sing to spontaneously. He is the one we ought to sing to sufficiently. And he is the one we ought to sing to spiritually. How, when, and why we celebrate God with our song and with our singing is as important to him as it is to us. Every one of us ought to have a song in our heart that we can sing in moments when we celebrate, in moments when we're contemplating, in moments when we're challenged, in moments when there are things that are charged up against us. And we should never sing simply just in the service of the sanctuary, even if it's virtual. But we ought to sing, brothers and sisters, even out in the streets and even in the middle of our struggles that we deal with in our life. The question for the morning is, can God count on you to sing like Moses when you see the goodness of the Lord in your life? Let's pray together. Lord God, we thank you for the gift of singing. We thank you for the gift of singing praises to your holy name. We thank you for this pattern of praise that you have shown to us this morning, that we can sing spontaneously, that we can sing sufficiently of your sufficiency, and that we can sing spiritually because you have saved us from all of our situations, and you can deliver us and serve us through your strong hand. And Lord, we praise you for what you've done. We praise you for what you're going to do in our life. In Jesus' name, amen. Now listen, brothers and sisters, we want to extend an invitation to some of you out there who need to change the way you sing and change what you sing about. Yeah, you've been singing, but you've been singing some songs that society has told you to sing. You've been singing some songs that sin has told you to sing, but we need you to sing some songs about the Savior. And you need to. We need you to embrace the Lord Jesus Christ today and turn your sinful songs into soulful songs and spiritual songs and songs of spontaneity and songs of sufficiency and songs that are sufficient about who he is, what he does, and how good he is, and how good he is in sending his son to preserve you alive in Jesus' name. Won't you do it? If you contact us at any of those points on the screen, we'll get in touch with you. And we'll promise you, we'll walk with you all the way. Brothers and sisters, I need to continue reiterating this, that we thank God for the gift of your support. We thank gift of your gifts to help us survive. We thank God for your gifts to help us serve. If you will be so kind to pray in your heart and in your spirit, if God will allow you to support this ministry in any way, there are ways that you can support us coming up on the screen. We promise you we'll be good stewards of it, because in order to be found faithful, God said you have to be a good steward. Brothers and sisters, we had about 20,000 cases across the state this past week. We had about 25,000 students in quarantine, about 2,000 or 3,000 teachers and staff members in educational systems in quarantine this week. Listen, we are thanking and praying and praising God that hopefully we will get more and more people vaccinated. More people are getting vaccinated, but we need you to continue encouraging everybody you know to get their first shot, to get their second shot. And what we're being told by the experts now is that there might be a third shot that might be needed. And that's not even the booster shot, but there may be a third shot that's needed. And get the third shot, and if you qualify, get the booster shot. Get every shot you can get. And even after you get them, wear your mask, wash your hands, watch your distance, so that we can limit the spread of this virus as much as we possibly can, so that we can develop within the community a place and safety and space that we can all get back to a new normal that looks like a normalcy without masks on. So we can see you, because watch this, as we get ready to go into the benediction, the Lord wants to look at your smiling, wonderful face everywhere you go. But guess what? He wants you to look to him first as we deal with this virus. Pray to him, turn from our way and seek his faith, and then he will hear, then he will heal, then he will deliver. Let's pray to you. Let's give the benediction for today. The Lord bless you and the Lord keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, and give you peace, and give you peace. Now let the whole church say, amen. Brothers and sisters, we'll see you next time.